Last night we had a huge reaction to a simple conversation about loneliness. Now, I know there's a lot of talk about worthy causes and suicide and mental health and all of these things, but there is sort of a big step back from that where millions of people are, and increasingly it's millions of Australian blokes who are fundamentally lonely. Now, we've got to do something about it. And sometimes it can be really simple things, little simple moments of outreach. Sometimes it can be a bit more complicated than that. Now, I thought rather than just banging around what I think should happen, I'll talk to a bloke who is part of a movement to make sure that we can take care of people, that we care. And if you are somebody that is lonely, I hope that you are inspired by this conversation. I want to thank all those people who sent me emails with their own stories of loneliness. And I want you to know that I understand the role that things like talkback radio and talk television play, that we're, in your life, mates. And I just want you to know that we care about you as mates. John Brogden is the chairman of Lifeline, and we had a chat just before we came on here.
We answer almost a million telephone calls a year, as you know, Paul, and about 60% of those are from people who live alone. And obviously, the more people who live alone are more likely to be lonely. That's a pretty obvious but proven fact. And what I worry about is you can hide in plain sight these days. You know, you can get down the shopping centre, there can be hundreds of people around you when you do your shopping, but you could be very lonely. And we walk past those people, we see those people, and we often think, no, we shouldn't say anything, and I reckon we should say something. How are you? You know, can I give you a hand with that? And have a chat. That's the least we can do. In our little street where we live, there's a very old couple who are there, so the kids next door take their bins up and drop them back again. And at the same time, you're also seeing if they're okay, if they're sick, if they're alive, all of those sorts of things. So we've, in the rush of the modern world, I know it sounds old-fashioned to say this, we do miss a bit of that human interaction and talking over the back fence. There'll always be people who live alone, but I think now we're so disconnected, and the irony is we keep saying we're so connected through social media. I don't think social media helps. I think it hurts lonely people.
Well, apart from the fact that social media is, in many ways, it's a performance, right? And if you're on a Facebook feed or Instagram feed, you see everyone else is on holidays, everyone else is happy, everyone else is busy, everyone else is having a five-star dinner, yeah. When the truth is that they might have been having a massive row before they had that dinner, but the photo looks great. And the truth is that just as Twitter isn't real life, Facebook images of people's life, the performance of other people's life, it's not real either.
Well, it's not real, and it can be, therefore, quite painful to those who aren't experiencing that. And I'm not saying you shouldn't put up your happy photos, but we need to welcome people in. It's a really basic, I mean, it's a very Australian value. You know, how's the old lady next door going? And how's the bloke whose wife just died going? You know, can we drop around and say good day? And one thing I learned in politics, interesting, is how to deal with these situations. And it's very old-fashioned. My grandmother would be very proud, which is you just turn up and knock on the door. And we've sort of got to that point where, in a societal sense, we don't think we should intrude. Well, you just turn up. You know, I think it's an old-fashioned thing to do. You turn up to the neighbour and you say, how are you going? And in many cases, you will be saving a life. If we can go to Lifeline and suicide, you will be maybe the only person they've seen in weeks and months. I saw a story about changes to Meals on Wheels delivery up on the north coast of New South Wales yesterday. And a little old lady said, this is the only visit I get all week. That's the only visit I get all week. And I thought, wow, that's, you know, you and I have families and kids and, you know, and we have lots of things to do. But just staying in touch with those people makes a big difference. And they are our aunties and uncles and cousins and all of that sort of stuff. And it also can happen very quickly. So people who go from a family situation where they might get divorced, for example, or they might have a death in the family, all of a sudden everything changes. And I had a great mate who passed away a couple of months ago from cancer, and his wife will be living alone now. And you say to yourself, no, bugger it, I'm going to give her a text every once in a while. I'm going to pick up the phone. We all spend hours in the bloody car. I'm just going to say g'day. I mean, what's the downside of that? And you know, those conversations, you never underestimate, Paul, how that conversation lifts somebody for the day.
What about for those that are lonely, that maybe they feel alone and maybe they're too nervous to accept that random call? What's your advice to somebody who's watching tonight who, you know, in their quiet moment, they're going to admit that they are lonely? Yeah. What can, should they do? What are the small things they can do to be reminded that they're one of 25 million, not 25 million other people and them?
Well, there are people who care, you know, and there are people who love them, and some of those people can be strangers. You know, they just they can be embraced. The other thing I'd say is Lifeline and other organisations exist for people to give a call, and we get a lot of lonely people who call us. They may not be suicidal, but they call us because they're in some form of loneliness or crisis. And once again, you know, there are lots of clubs out there, organisations that need volunteers. I mean, we, you know, involved in the surf club down on with our children, and you know, most of those clubs are run by the same 15 people, but they'd love a new volunteer, and they feel they'd make you feel very welcome. So don't sit at home, don't think there isn't a place for you. I think many people just, particularly as they get older, I think, lose their place in society. So don't suffer in silence, and know that there are people who want to help you through. And it literally could be your next door neighbour. And it's hard. Look, people fall out with their families over a long period of time. They don't have, you know, fewer and fewer people have children who look after them as they get older. And we live longer too. This, on the flip side of that coin, you know, we live a long time now, and we live a long time with medical support, and, you know, people get quite lonely.
He's a good bloke, big figure in my life too, John Brogden, chairman of Lifeline. The number is 13 11 14 for Lifeline, but most importantly, just do a little something for someone who might be a stranger. God forbid, next time you go to, say, a petrol station, rather than just thinking it's a meat puppet who takes your money, just ask them how they are. Say good day, find out a little bit about their family, and do it for the driver at this and the person for that, and find someone in your phone you haven't spoken to for a while, and try and bury the hatchet with some old grudges, okay? But I appreciate all of the stories, and I'll keep reading through them and reply to your emails. pmurray@skynews.com.au.